And we are live. Hello, everyone. Welcome back. We're going to get started with one of those bad boys right there. How is everyone doing this evening?
Welcome back.
That was a little loud. My apologies. Let's take it right from the top. Mr. Gary Davlin, dude, first in the house this evening, followed up by Grandpa Joe, who I'm very jealous about because... what was it, four boxes of Brooklyn Bakery cookies, Grandpa Joe? Dwight Bailey in the house, Brian from Oregon. Dude, what's up? Dusty, Wendell, Dana Van Jay, House of Twang, Janice. Hello, Janice, how are you? Who else is in the house? Grumpy Mike. Hopefully you're not feeling grumpy on this fine Friday evening. By the way, today is, there's 1 minute left to November 5th. 2021. Today is the youngest we will all ever be. Who else? Wendell, Johnny Rock, Craig, the Dank Savatron. Metal makes me crazy. AQ, dude. By the way, I have to a huge shout out. AQ Music is just incredibly generous. So I have to tell you, know, I should have brought the box down, but I didn't. So I'll just tell the story. So, last week, it was Chad Boston. I mailed him my Sweetwater candy. and I love the, what is it called, the Laffy Taffy? And AQ Music sent me a box. I didn't count them. There must have been 100 in there of Laffy Taffy. And he was like, since you gave yours away, he wanted to do something nice for me, which was incredibly generous. And that's not the first time, by the way. He also is a very good listener, because he also sent me an entire bag of Bit of Honey. So he's either very generous or he wants to get me really, really hooked on the sweets, or maybe both. But Anthony, dude, thank you so much, man. Very, very kind of you. And how is everyone doing this evening? Hope everyone is doing well. Ron Padgett likes Laffy Taffy. I'll tell you, you know, I'm not really that much of a sweet person, but there's just a few that I really enjoy. Those two, Laffy Taffy and Bit of Honey, are amongst the top. Terry Himes, hello. Got to use the Armin by Guild, purple single cut. Nice, USA pickups. Very cool. Bit of Honey is good. Mm-hmm. I love honey. If it has honey, I love it. In fact, I don't even think they make them anymore. Anyone remember the, was it Luden's cough drops that made the honey? The honey, they were like oval shaped. Who made those? I used to love those. And I haven't seen them. They were like gummy-esque, right? Harder than a gummy bear. They say you are what you eat. I'm sweet, man. You know, I like the sweet stuff. So I am what I am. I am what I eat. I'm sweet. Is that a challenge? What? Oh, pines. That was it. Pines. I knew somebody would know that. Hold on. Where did it go? Pine Brothers. Pine Brothers honey cough drops. They were like legit good. They were like candy. So what was the challenge, AQ? I saw your thing about a challenge, but I didn't quite get it. Little Holmes, dude, what's up? Yeah, it was the, let me go back up again. Pine Brothers. Are they even still around? I like Twix. Twix is even better if it's frozen. Thank you, Little Holmes. The real My Knees Hurt. Is there a fake My Knees Hurt? Oh no, dude. No, that's not a challenge. We're just BSing. Oh, that's funny. What Friedman head is that? That is the Jake E. Lee. The Jake E. Lee. The J-E-L 100. The Gel 100. Really? Someone cloned you. How about that? The Great Vanzini in the house? Can you guess the pedal? No. Steve from Boston. Somebody block Steve from Boston. He's banned. Dude, in fact, if you'd like to join, let me know, and I'll send you a link. If you'd like to join, but if you're just kind of hanging home and all that, let me know. Text me if you'd like to join. I should have texted you before. Dude, we haven't caught up in a while. Little Holmes says, I am a gentleman from day one, a class act. Thank you, Little Holmes. I appreciate that. And I do try to, you know, be a gentleman. How many guitars do you own now and amps and pedals? I have about 15 guitars, 10 pedals, and about 5 amps. Right in that ballpark. Send. All right, I'm gonna bring Steve from Boston in. So let me send an email real quick. Does everyone want Steve to join us? The YouTuber formerly known as Pixie Licks. Invite guest to the broadcast. Click copy to clipboard. Okay. Dude, I'm gonna send it over Skype. Because every time I send you an email from my Gmail, you don't get it. And he has to make coffee, so it'll be 10 minutes. But dude, look on Skype. That's where it'll be. All right, so in 10 minutes, Steve from Boston will be joining us. And in the meantime, let me tell you a little bit about this guitar here. So I unboxed this guitar, testing, 1, 2, 3. Testing, okay. So I unboxed this guitar last week. This here is a D'Angelico, okay, Premier, DC, double cut. And this one here is a semi-hollow, pine, so kind of very bright. Let me give you some spec on this. So this is a semi-hollow. The body shape is called the Premier DC for double cutaway. Laminated maple, ocean turquoise. The neck is also maple, Ovenkahl fingerboard, 14-inch radius, 24 medium frets. Seymour Duncan designed an HB-102N and an HB-101B, and basically that means a jazz in the neck and a 59 in the bridge. Two-volume, two-tone, three-way toggle. And it also comes with a gig bag, and they do make a really nice, affordable hard shell case for this. And it's just a beautiful guitar. In fact, you know, for me, the litmus test is when you take a guitar out of the case in the house, does the family say wow, or do they say, oh, it looks like everything else you own, right? This was a wow. I got a lot of wows on this guitar. So this is a beautiful guitar. It doesn't break the bank. I put a link in the description if you want to see. Now, this particular one might be out of stock. I may have gotten the last one on this one here. I did get this from Sweetwater. And, you know, I should also plug that Sweetwater, and listen, my unbiased opinion, I think that they do a phenomenal job with checking everything before it goes out. They have the whole 55-point inspection. And even things like, you know, of course, they're supposed to check the guitar over, but like, just to give you an example, and by the way, I included that link in the description below in terms of what's in the 55-point inspection, but let me give you an example of why I appreciate that. Sometimes when you get a new guitar day, and you have, you tune it up, you play it, it's out of tune, you tune it up, you play it. What a lot of people don't realize is you're supposed to stretch your strings. They do that. So stuff like that just makes the experience better for the person buying from Sweetwater. They go through it, so hopefully there's no surprises. We've all probably had a surprise or two along the way, and you know their goal is really to minimize that. With that said, I'm going to give you a lick and a riff on this guitar here, and then Steve from Boston will be joining us. So let me make sure I'm not clipping here. you can see the decibel meter. We are playing at room volume, so let me bring this down a little bit. Neck pickup. Bridge pickup. Oh, Phil Smith in the house, dude. What is up? So really, really nice cleans out of here. What I'm gonna, interestingly enough, a guitar like this is, you know, it's a very ES-335-esque guitar. Really, I mean, it's got humbuckers, it's got the center block, so that suppresses a lot of the sustain, a lot of the squeal from a full hollow, that's why it's semi-hollow, that block running down the center. So I'm gonna throw some gain on here, and we could hear what it sounds like. Rock and roll stuff. Have one question: if generals are gathered in the masses. So that's the guitar. I mean, it's a beast with gain. Again, it's got the 59 and the jazz. It's a nicely balanced guitar. Let me pop the strap off. It's just a, you know, binding on the front, binding on the back, binding on the neck, and perhaps one of the most exotic headstocks out there. And what's interesting here about D'Angelico, you know, it was a, you know, right out of New York City, they used to make jazz boxes, I think from the 30s to the 60s, then they went out of business and then they came back. So they really kind of resurfaced a New York City brand. So bet it would sound good with an even tide delay. I have Mad Raj in the house. So the Jakey Lee is actually going into my Eventide black hole and the micro pitch. So I will switch over to the gel 100 and let's check out how that sounds. In the fields, the bodies are burning. Can we get it? You know, there's like a 30 second delay though. I'll follow the lyrics in the thing. It sounds really good through the Jakey Lee. Politicians hide themselves away. They only started the war. Absolutely. Benjamin Payne says, no. Turn it up. Yeah. Did I hit 103? I can't hear you. I'm kidding. Don't do that at home, by the way. This is like a controlled environment. So, anyway, that is the that's the D'Angelico. What do you think of that? It got to 106? So, just a beautiful guitar, and again, you really can't beat Sweetwater. Testing, 1, 2, 3. Test, there we go. And it's a nice guitar, so, you know, it'll... right around here, right? That's it right there. So I'm gonna put this down. Bear with me 1 second. Chad Boston says, got the candy, thank you. And thank you for everything. Dude, it is my pleasure. And thanks to you, Chad. I don't know if you just joined, but the backstory on the candy was because I gave my candy to you, AQ Music in the house actually sent me a whole box of candy. So you're welcome. Thank you, as always, for the super chat. And AQ, dude, thank you. Are the inlays light blue? That's a good question. I don't think so. No, they are like a mother of pearl. Thank you, Ken Rogers. So what's interesting, too, is they make the DC and the DC Mini. They make both of these, which would be, I guess, in Gibson terms, 335 and a 339. And it really depends what you dig. This is the iconic shape, but the 339 is, too. In fact, I think I've shown my Kramer Knight Rider, which is actually an ES 339 shape. The Joan Jett, as an example, is a 339 shape. This is the straight-up 335 shape. Oh, Great Vanzini says, would love to try an Epi George Thorogood White Fang. Just wish it wasn't white. I'll tell you, I like that guitar too. But I actually like that it's white. It's kind of like this. It's that big, oversized, except I think that might be a full hollow body. So, let me just check something real quick. And Steve from Boston should be joining us momentarily. I actually wish I had a cup of coffee. I have a boring bottle of water. Thanks, Avatron says, candies in the shape of picks would make a great merch. You know what would be a good merch is the homemade chocolate templates. Remember like in grade school when they had like the fair and they'd have like whatever, like the lollipops with the, you know, like the melted chocolate and shapes? Yeah, that's actually a good idea. Grumpy Mike, dude, thank you so much for the tone jar and why not? Damn, I love blue guitars. And that's stunning. That's a stunning. It's you know, Pelham blue is one of my favorite colors. And that's more of a turquoise, but depending on the way the light hits it or the way the picture takes it, it could maybe pass for a Pelham, which is why I picked that one out, to be honest with you. I love that. But the turquoise is nice also. It's a beautiful guitar. Tone King toilet seats. That's an interesting one. Was that because of my Instagram post? It would have to be a throne, absolutely. So let me share with you something else here. This is just going to be a quick unboxing. And so unboxing. So what I got today, I think, or maybe yesterday, was brand new. In fact, just before, when I went into the Friedman, you got to hear the, I don't know if you could see it, but I have the black hole and the micro pitch, the Eventide pedals. And those were two brand new pedals by Eventide. And they came out with a third. Coincidentally, it's called the Tri Sarah Chorus. And it's the same exact form factor. Let me put this down over here. It's called Tricera because it has like three different chorus types, a chorus or choral. And I forget exactly what the name of the other one was. Was it a chorus? Oh, and vibrato. So this is the pedal. I know there's some demos out there on that, but that is the pedal. And I will hook this up so you'll get to hear this live next week. I'll hook up the multicam thing and you'll hear it with the two other pedals. But this has, oh, it's right on here. Chorus, vibrato, and choral. Or choral, depending on how you read it. Rate, detune, and then a left, a center, and right. And every knob can do double duty here. So you have delay, filter, and output level. And this little ladder here, which has some presets, then you could create. You could also create your own. You could hook it up to USB. And it also has stereo output, expression output, so on and so forth. Guitar level, line level. Basically, Eventide is coming out with like the smaller pedal form factors of their old 80s rack gear that lots of pro musicians, studio musicians used. And they're releasing that, but this actually has even more features than what was in the Rack Gear. And again, you know, technology catches up, so they could do a whole lot more in a smaller form factor. So this came, this is the unboxing. There's also a link in the description. Again, you could see lots of demos on that. I'm really excited to get this going. And just to give you a sneak peek into what I'm thinking for a demo is, you know, a lot of people will put something like this on and play clean stuff and you get to hear chorus. Okay. For me, what I'm interested in hearing is, can I kind of nail that Zakk Wylde style where he used the chorus with the gain to give you that really, that Zakk Wylde tone, right? So I want to fiddle around with this. Of course, I'll play it clean so you could hear what it sounds like. But I'm going to try to get this to pair up with the Jake E. Lee, which is really kind of like a hot-rodded plexi style amp. I'll hook this up. So next week, tune in if you want to hear this, and we will we'll get this going. And then I'll also talk a little bit about how you place it with your other effects, right? Because I also have a delay, and I have a reverb, and just kind of the chain and the order, and how all of that should work. Now, here's something else that's interesting, is they make some cool stuff. So first of all, if you buy the pedal new, that link is also in the description, you get, well, I don't have to pull it out, but you get a nice Eventide sticker, you get feet for the pedal, you get a nice Eventide pick, you get a cheat sheet, okay? You also get in here, and this is the fun thing about doing unboxing, is you kind of get to see what sometimes you can see. USB cable, and then power, multi-power. So if you're in the UK or you're in Europe, you have all your adapters. So you get all of that as well. Okay? So everything you need, no matter where you are in the world. And that is that. That's not hooked up today. But like I said, stay tuned, and you will hear this next week. With that said, let's get a drum roll for Mr. Steve from Boston. Here we go. Dude.
Can you see me?
And you're really loud. Hang on.
And you have to put on headphones.
I know. Give me 1 second. I'll throw some headphones on. Hang on. And let me do this also so we don't look like that Norm MacDonald interview.
Can you see me in the video?
I don't see me.
Oh, I see you. Does everyone see Steve from Boston?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you see me?
I do.
Okay. Oh, we just lost him. I'm sure he'll be back. Let me send him a Skype message real quick. While I get headphones, hang on. Oh, and here he is again. Hang on 1 second. Dude, you're back. Let me fix my headphone thing. Hold on. Testing 1, 2, 3. Dude, can you hear me?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
I hear you. Yep,
okay.
No echoes?
No echo. Echo.
Dude, you're the only person that I have to put headphones on to talk.
Well, you know.
Very high maintenance.
I am very high maintenance. Very high mate.
So what do you think of the guitar that I just showed?
Is the pedal? Oh wait, I'm getting something. I'm getting something. Equal ocean. No. Balanced. Surf.
We all listen. We all know you're a cheater.
Am I close?
You're close.
My only regret was that I didn't play it up and go, you know, wait, you know, I know you. I know you like the custom.
Yeah, you just came out with it.
I know you like the 24. You know what I should have said, though? I should have said, and it's going to be in black. And that would have blown your mind.
Because that would have blown.
A complete guess.
Yeah.
But a good guess, an educated guess.
So you cheated and you failed in the delivery.
Yes.
Oh, man. So what do you think of the D'Angelico?
Oh, I like the D'Angelico. It looks nice. Does Aljon know about that guitar?
I didn't see him in the chat. Hopefully we'll dodge him. If he comes in, we'll.
I don't know. It's got 335 vibes. It's got the Pelham Blue sort of look there.
Did I throw some Gibson words saying, at that?
You might be stepping on toes there.
Yeah, you know, the way I look at it is, well, first of all, that's a compliment, right?
Yeah.
You know. But we all know we love all different kinds of guitars, right?
Yes.
So.
Of course. As long as they're Strats.
As long as they're Gibsons and Fenders.
Exactly.
Oh, he saw it last week when I unboxed it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Probably haven't heard from him since.
I have been blacklisted from Aljon. Nah, man. Aljon, I think we all know Aljon is good company.
He is.
And Aljon likes gear. For those that don't know Aljon, he likes gear the way we like gear, right? Of course, he works for Gibson and Kramer, but...
Yeah.
Then again, you know, I have had him on. I don't know if I had him on this show, but I've definitely had him on like Patreon show. Guy owns more Gibsons than anyone I know. You know.
Yeah.
Mad Raj says Steve Peavy has a new combo amp that you will need to demo 5 years from now.
Yeah, but they have to send it to me now, and then I'll demo it 5 years from now.
Did Peavy come out with a new amp?
Who knows?
Oh, because I saw Aljon. There he is. Aljon. There he is. Hold on. We'll duck.
We drew him out.
So Aljon, Steve was saying that perhaps you would be upset that I was explaining the D'Angelico with Gibson-esque terms.
I was going to say, Aljon, I remain faithful.
I was saying it looks like a Pelham Blue.
Unlike this guy.
It's like a 335 shape. But I was saying that's a compliment. That's a compliment.
Oh yeah, no, everyone is very complimented.
And we were also talking about the George Thorogood white Fang.
Now, who makes that? Is that a
come
Gretsch?
On?
Is that who makes?
You know, you're on Al John's bad list now too, because it's Epiphone, not Gretsch. See that, Aljon? He thought it was a Fender product. He didn't even give you
I knew it was Epiphone. I just wanted to hear you say it.
So have you gotten anything new?
No, not really. You know what I did get, but I'm going to unbox it tomorrow, is...
Unbox it here.
All right, you ready?
You could do a
new phone.
It's a brand new car.
I got a new camera.
Oh yeah, you get?
You know, it's by Insta 360.
Insta 360.
Yeah, they're like a GoPro competitor. I did a video about.
You're really pissed at GoPro, aren't you?
Oh, I was pissed at them. And they reached out to me, and they're like, hey, we love your anger at GoPro. We would love to send you one of our cameras. I'm like, send it over.
Wow.
Yeah. So it showed up yesterday.
And how does it stack up?
I don't know. I haven't unboxed it yet.
Oh, okay. And it's like GoPro footprint type thing?
I open it up, as all these spiders are going to crawl out. Oh, no! Yeah. Should be good though. It's a tiny camera.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a little clip-on cam. So So should be interesting. It really is tiny.
You know, it's interesting when you think about the size of the camera in an iPhone, as an example, or whatever phone you use. They're tiny, and it's probably no different than what's in a GoPro, and it just makes your traditional DSLR or camcorder. I know it's the glass lenses and the glass zoom. But I mean, heck, it's, you know, they're even putting them in cars now. It used to be just for the backup. Now, like the Teslas, they're all over the car. In fact, they say it's the hardest car to break into because of all the cameras around it.
Right.
You know,
I did some night shots with my big cams, which they were fine. As long as I had a fast lens on it, you know, like a 1.7 mm-hmm. or a 1.8, no problem mm-hmm. at all. But the GoPro, it was pissing me off because when you were look at it on the screen, it would look amazing, right? It would look all like grainy. Then you'd hit the record button and it would switch and it would be like nice, like it was doing some like noise reduction on the spot. And I was like, wow, that image is really good once you hit the record button. But the video looked like just absolute garbage.
On the playback?
On the GoPro, yeah. It did not look like it looked on the screen. It looked like it's in the preview. And I was like, oh, what are you doing?
Well, my last two outdoor videos that I did, that was 100% shot with GoPro. Every angle was a GoPro.
Yeah, but that was in the daytime. I shot at night. And trust me, nighttime,
right,
the GoPro
right.
does not want to hear it. What I didn't check out and what bummed me out is my Samsung has an amazing video camera in it. Three different lenses, all optical, optical wide, optical narrow, and optical zoom, 10x zoom, and it's optical.
I have can you see that? It's kind of dark. I have 10x on my XXA20, is it?
Oh, yeah.
That's the one I brought to GitCon and everywhere else. Thing's a beast. Yeah, I mean, it only shoots 1080, but the Canon.
Yeah. But, you know, the phone can do up to 8K. It can do 4K like nothing. And in the pro mode with HDR 10 plus on, the video looks like goddamn film. And at night, I had it outside. It looked stunning. I was like, oh, what was I thinking? Just throw that in a gimbal. And it would have been like rock solid. I don't know I was thinking.
Andrew Boniker in the house, dude. What is up? Andrew, how do you think that compares to the iPhone 13?
I don't know. I do know that Samsung does put a lot into their video stuff, though. And I can tell you, I'm always impressed with the quality of the shots that I get out of the camera. It's pretty damn good. Google video is pretty good too, but it's so much software processing, right? They do it, and it's a stunning result, don't get me wrong, but it's done through like uploading it to Google and letting their like servers like AI fix it and send it back. It's like, it seems to be pretty, I think the new Apple does that too, right? There's a lot of like sort of onboard, like an AI chip built on that helps.
All I know is when I back up like my photos to Google, it says, what does it say? Something like, we can store like our own version of this unless you want the original, and that our version will be enhanced and blah, blah, blah. It's like, you know, they're taking data storage to a whole new level, you know? We'll fix it. We'll not only store it, we'll fix it for you.
Oh, yeah. No, they can do all kinds of enhancements online now. Yep. It's pretty crazy.
Phil Smith says Samsung and Apple are neck to neck. They're really pushing to bring very high end quality to the mass market.
No, the video quality was stunning. You forget about it. You know, you just forget the quality video it can take. And I'm saying, well, I have my GoPro and I have my, you know, my Lumix. I guess that's what I'm using. And I never even gave my phone a thought, but it would have probably been the best of the three, quite frankly.
You still like your Lumix? I think I have two that are just like yours.
Yeah.
And they have 4K.
I got three of them. I love them.
Yeah, I have two of them.
I bought a G7, so I have four cameras total, but I hate that G7. I should just sell it.
Is the G7, I'm not even sure the model I have. There's the one that was made for video, and there's the one that does video but wasn't purposely made for video.
Well, the G7, the G7 was the first sort of foray into like pretty decent like 4K video and 1080p. Like it had a couple of flaws.
I have the G85.
Yeah, that's what I have. They don't put out cameras every year, but the G85 came out the year after the G7 because the G7 had flaws.
So you have one G7 and two G85s?
Yeah, and the problem is I bought the G7 after I bought my first G85 because it was under $500. They couldn't give them away because it was, you know, it has known flaws. Mm-hmm. And not so much for video, for still photos. At a certain shutter speed, not above it or below it, but at a very certain, right at the right frequency, the sensor shakes. The vibration.
Oh, interesting.
And you can never get a sharp photo in this little window. Mm-hmm. If you're above it, you're fine. If you're below it, you're fine. But in one little area, you'll never get a sharp photo because it shakes. They got rid of that on the G85. It's got the five-way stabilization, and they reinforced with like a carbon fiber bracket so that it wasn't going to vibrate like unintentionally. And they fixed it in the G85, but
Grumpy Mike has two Lumix G85s also. And Grumpy Mike, you have good quality in your videos. You know what's interesting? I never shot a video with the G85. I only use it for my multicam setup.
Oh, really?
Yep.
Wait, so you still use the Canon for most of your vids?
I use the GoPros.
Oh, really? You use the GoPros?
It's just easier. It's right. So light. You could throw three or four GoPros in a bag, you know, like a little thing.
Right.
But just for when I do the, like, the multi-camera demos, I just took up the G85s.
Hmm.
You know? In fact, I have a Blackmagic switcher here, and I was trying to hook it up to a Windows 7 machine that was like, yeah, no.
Yeah. Yeah, that new Intel processor came out, but I don't think you get full speed unless you have Windows 11, which is, I don't know if you've ever worked in Windows 11, but it's frustrating. You know, they just changed too much. I wish you could just change it back to whatever it was in Windows 10. I'm so used to Windows 10 now that when I go to 11, it's like,
that's always the case. I don't, it's annoying. Yeah.
It's annoying. It's like, stop moving crap around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. R. Farah Mentum said, yeah, but the audio is so bad on GoPro. The truth is, audio is bad on all cameras. You know, you always need a separate audio track.
Actually, the audio got better starting with the Hero 7. They started to, and then the 8, it was a big jump forward because they added like more
front and back.
Front and back, and then it listens it listens, and it can like cancel out, and it knows the direction you're facing it. Like, it's actually pretty clever.
Mm-hmm.
It's gotten much better. In fact, there was a guy that had done several videos where he takes it out on a jet ski, right? Because it's so
interesting,
right? And it's moving up and down, you know what I'm saying? So it really tests out the leveling, it tests out the wind resistance, it tests out the sound. I mean, it's kind of a torture test to go out on a jet ski with a GoPro on it, right?
Right.
And when he got to the eight, it was like stunning. Like, wow, that really does cut out all the noise, really does cut out all the wind, really does. You can hear him talking. You know, it was like, it was pretty amazing. It was it was a huge leap forward. You know, so. But the 10 is overheating. A lot of people sending their 10s back.
Really, I got the 9.
Yeah, I got a 9 too.
Yeah, I got the 9 over the summer.
Yeah, every September they come out with a camera.
Yep.
So I usually wait till they.
You know, you were pissed also at GitCon because you bought the latest and greatest. You brought it there, and it was overheating in your pocket too, if you remember that.
I had recorded a video, and I thought I had pressed stop, but apparently I didn't. I put it in my pocket. And it's recording in like 4K video. And it got so friggin' hot. I took it out. I showed it to Shane. I'm like, dude, check it out. And he's like, oh my God. I'm like, dude. He's like, that is stunningly hot. I'm like, I know. He goes, I can't believe it didn't melt. I'm like, I know. It's unbelievable. And I just left it open. But now it had shut itself off, I think, in self-preservation.
I think Casey Neistat did a video on GoPros melting.
He
had hooked one up to his front door, like as a security camera, and it was like on 24/7. And he said it'll go until it must have been the battery, but something actually melts.
Interesting. Yeah, yeah, I found out that when I went to NAMM and I wanted to use it all day, I didn't want to carry the year before. I carried a bunch of batteries. Which battery have I used? Battery haven't I used? Charging batteries, a nightmare. So I have that same brick you have, you know, that one that it's like I forget who is it.
APC.
I got the same one. APC. We know.
Okay. We know, yeah.
We know. So I got the same APC you do.
Mm-hmm.
And
and
I got it. Let's not veer off. We both have an APC, okay? We both do.
That was the best part.
Yeah. Oh no, that was the best thing in the box. And so I had it charged up, and I got a USB converter for my G85, right? Mm-hmm. It's a little battery brick, and it's got a little voltage converter.
Mm-hmm.
And it, you know, you run that in, right? But it has to be at least, like, I think 1.7 or 2 amps coming out and to run it. But it's plenty. The APC, mm-hmm. the APC can do it.
Mm-hmm.
And
mine is still going.
Oh, so is mine. And yeah. I just used it recently.
Yep. I keep it on the charger.
Yeah.
And if I'm running out and my phone's dying, I just bring the APC.
Yeah. And I would run the GoPro into it. But the problem with the GoPro is it would function. In fact, I bought even a special door that had a hole in it for the USB, right? So you mm-hmm. could just plug the USB and run it all day.
Yep.
And but it didn't work like that. It was annoying when you plugged in the charger, you know, the APC, it would charge the battery, but the second you hit record, it stopped charging and it went right through the battery and would start to piss right through the battery.
Oh, you know what I use for the GoPros? The Rockboard batteries.
Oh, yeah. And so I figure out that if you just take the battery out, it runs straight off of the USB.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
And if you leave the door completely off, you know.
Wait, so I lost you. If you have the battery in there, but the battery is dying, and you plug it.
If you have a battery in it, period,
mm-hmm.
it operates like this. When you hit record, it works solely off the internal battery. When you turn it off, it starts to charge from the external source.
No, it can't be, because I've had GoPros that were dying battery-wise. Yeah. I plug it into the Rockboard charger. I hit record on the GoPro because I'm ready to record. And by the time I'm done with the video, it's like a full charge. It's actually getting power and charging.
I wasn't getting that. I was losing power. Mine would not charge and record at the same time. It was
mine charged and recorded.
And I figured all I did was just pull the battery out and I could go all day.
Yeah,
and it didn't overheat because it didn't have a battery in it.
That's strange.
Right.
All of yours did that? Because I plug in the 5, the 6, and the 9, and they all work the same way. They will charge while they record.
Yeah, no, I had the, I was using the 8.
Maybe that.
The 8 wouldn't do it. As soon as I hit record, I started to lose juice. Now maybe it wouldn't change the screen when it was running, and if I had turned it off, it would have showed it. But I started to use it, and I realized I was losing battery. I was like, "Oh my god, I don't have it plugged in." I was like, "What? I do have it plugged in." What's going on? And I realized it wouldn't. It was one or the other. As soon as it was recording, it wouldn't charge, and I was like, "This is weird." Because you know what I'm saying? It's like when you plug it in.
Maybe that was a thing on the 8, because I remember you were having problems with the 8.
I don't know. I never tried it with the 7, so I never, and I haven't, quite frankly, I haven't tried it with the 9, because I haven't had to. I haven't gone to a show.
Right.
You know.
Yeah, there really hasn't been much. NAMM is, so for those that don't know, was it Summer NAMM was rescheduled in Winter NAMM, right?
Who knows what they're going to do. I don't like NAMM in the summer. That's when Disney is at its, you know, it's going, and the hotels are much more expensive.
Wait, you're talking you don't want Summer NAMM in Nashville?
I don't want.
You don't want Summer NAMM in Anaheim?
Yeah. I don't want the Anaheim show in the summer.
Right. I got you.
Okay, I don't want the Anaheim show past about, what, May 15th, whenever, right, like, a certain amount of kids get out of school in this country.
Right,
for
right.
The summer, because their bookings start to go up, and their rates for hotels go up commensurate with it.
Right.
The whole point of that thing in January is that it's off-season for Disney, which, as you know, is directly across the street from the NAMM show.
Yep.
I mean, literally directly across the
street. Right across the street, yep.
I mean, it's right there. Every hotel is there to service Disney. I mean, how many of those hotels do you walk into when it's Tigger and Pooh and friggin' Mickey Mouse? And you know what I'm saying? All the Disney stuff. I just think June, money-wise, it looks tough. Mm-hmm. It looks real tough. I was looking, and prices were ridiculous.
So when is the next one scheduled for? I think it's January, isn't it?
It's June.
Oh, they're not doing one in January?
No.
Oh. So they postponed it a whole other year.
Six months. Yeah. More than a year.
Yeah.
Right? Because they missed 2021. It's not going to be January 2022. It's about an 18-month.
Right.
Wait. And so it's going to go June of 2022. And, you know, when you look up a hotel room and, you know, a room that's normally $130, but the week of NAMM, you know, is $350, and you go on and it's $1,500.
Well,
and
no, you're it's dude, it's more than that, because we went to NAMM 2020, January 2020. We were in Anaheim. Then they canceled Summer NAMM. They canceled Winter NAMM. They canceled Summer NAMM again. So that's
No. They had a Summer NAMM this year.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
If you blinked, you missed it.
Well, they had the table with the like QR codes.
They had a table with a QR code. Thank you, yeah. And have a great summer. How much did it cost you to get here? $800 flight.
Yeah.
$900 in hotel rooms. $300 in incidentals. Anyway, here's your QR code.
Yep.
Hey, the thing that saved it for people is they went over to the Gibson Garage, which had just opened.
Right.
So it was sort of something new. At least there was something you could go to.
Mm-hmm.
But,
mm-hmm.
You know, it was probably more interesting than the friggin' NAMM show, which looked like a...
I went to the Gibson Factory a few summer NAMMs ago. They had a whole barbecue, open house type of thing. Pretty fascinating. Old school,
yeah.
Too.
Yeah. No, we went. We all got Gibson Les Paul customs as we were walking out. I'm sure you did, too.
Yeah. They let us pick all the material and the finish. And so you got the stock. We got the custom build.
Exactly, the custom build. Yeah. They take a drop of your blood and they put it in the paint as a part of the DNA series.
I think Aljon's comment says, come to the Gibson Garage. I interpret
that's what I'm saying, the Gibson Garage. You know, forget the factory tour. Like, we've all done that.
But yeah. I think Aljon is telling us that he is inviting us to the Gibson Garage.
Oh.
He'll fly us out, put us up. right? That's yeah. how I read that.
Reading that.
That's how I'm reading that.
Standby, your ticket verification codes will be arriving on your phone shortly. You will be.
Maybe I'm reading too much into this, but
4 days and three nights, luxurious downtown Nashville.
I'll tell you, I like summer now. I love the food.
Oh, I love it.
Hattie B's and the barbecue. What's the barbecue's place? What is it called? Jack's.
Oh, there's Martin's. I like
Jack's.
There's the Oinker or something. There's one that's downtown that's pretty good. And what's the other one there?
Well, Jack's is the one right on Broadway.
Modell's.
Mm-hmm.
That place is killer.
Hmm.
It's like Southern comfort food.
Okay.
You know, they're passing around, you know, you sit at a table. If we go with a large enough party that we get our own table, but you would be sitting with, you know, if you're there with your girlfriend, you're going to go in and sit at a table with a bunch of other strangers. Mm-hmm. And, it's family style. And they just show up with a basket of biscuits and you pass it around and a big giant plate of fried chicken and just everything you could possibly imagine. And they like, and they will just keep feeding you until you say you're done.
Right. Really? Interesting. Yeah. What is it called again?
I think it's Monell's.
Hmm.
But, Porky. the Porker place. Yeah.
Interesting. But Hattie B's? That's like amazing.
Hattie B's is really good.
Yeah.
But they say Prince's is the original.
Hmm.
But Prince's is, so for some people, a little too hot.
Well, that's like if you've ever gone up to Buffalo, New York, there's two hot wing places. The one in the airport, I forget the name of it. They like to claim they're the original hot wing, but it's actually not. It's a place called Duffy's or Duff's.
Mm.
What's the place? Somebody help me out here. What's the hot wing place in Buffalo Airport? Somebody will know. But it's actually Duff's. That was like the original hot wing.
Peg Leg Porker. Aljon had it. There it is.
Peg Leg Porker.
Yeah, that's a good place.
Yep.
Martin's was real good. And it's Modell's or Monell's. I think it's Monell's, that place.
Anchor Bar. Thank you. Sofa King. He was Sofa King right. It's Anchor Bar.
Huh.
Thank you, Sofa King.
You know, when I grew up, there was a sub shop in the square called D'Angelo's. They eventually became something big.
What are you talking about?
When I was a kid, there was one place in the square called D'Angelo Subs, and he turned that place into a national chain.
Which was?
D'Angelo Subs.
That's a national chain?
It was. It's certainly regional.
Oh, I never heard of it.
You never heard of D'Angelo's?
Nope.
Not Papa John's.
We have over here.
You never heard of Papa Gino's?
Papa Gino's, yes. Yeah. Yes.
So Papa Gino's eventually bought D'Angelo's and they're sort of tied together.
Although
now.
We don't have a Papa Gino's over here. I don't know if it's a New Jersey thing. Subwise, we have Jersey Mike's. We have, and then of course, Subway, which I actually like. And Blimpy, did Blimpy go out?
We don't have Blimpies around here. The only time I saw one when I was on business, I was traveling to Madison, Wisconsin. I had a Blimpies. Yeah. It's the only time I ever drove by one.
Hmm.
But I don't remember one around here. But yeah. We didn't really have Papa John's around here, but they came in and they're kind of gone. That guy didn't survive. A couple of them didn't survive. And then the other one was Krispy Kreme. They came up here and it was all the news. Krispy Kreme's.
I love Krispy Kreme.
Krispy Kreme's coming to town. Oh, Dunks is in trouble. The Krispy Kreme's coming to town. They went under. Gone. See ya.
I'll tell you what. I could handle my sugar, but two Krispy Kreme donuts, I'm like a child that had way too much sugar.
Oh, yeah.
They're insane. Dusty said Jersey Mike's is overpriced. So, Dusty, I took my youngest son there one time. And we stood in line. You know, I'm not paying attention to the price. It's like a sub, right? What could a sub cost? And we got the large. $18. I didn't realize the large was like an Italian loaf of bread, you know, like.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we spent about $20 a sandwich. It was like insane. And we ate like a quarter of it. We went home with basically, yeah, just
a good story.
Yeah. we went home with a good story. So, but my favorite actually is the cold cut combo at Subway.
You doing an ad right now?
Well, they gave me $50,000 to tell everyone.
Yeah, he's gonna say.
I wish
this platinum card ain't free.
So, let me tell everyone about Subway.
Yeah, the super cold cut combo. I eat one for lunch every day.
But my just to be clear, I'm giving my honest, like, Subway has nothing to do with this. I like a 12-inch Subway cold cut combo with some black olives, onions, and mayo. That's it. And cheese. Provolone.
So is the cold cut combo supposed to be like an Italian?
Cold cut combo is turkey-based, so it's like turkey ham, turkey bologna, turkey whatever the other one is. Gotcha, it's like three turkey. It's called the cold cut combo. Trust me, you'll thank me after you have it. The cold cut combo.
Yeah, Quiznos is the other one that went under. You ever go to Quiznos?
I've had Quiznos, and I was like, eh. You know?
Yeah, it's a bit of a spectacle.
Remember the ground round?
Oh, I do. When I was a kid, holy shit, the ground round. I remember. Oh my god, I remember going there as a little kid, and going to like my cousin's like birthday party at the ground round, and they had the popcorn, and we were like throwing popcorn everywhere, and I just remember I was so little. I can't believe I remember this. I just remember it was like chaos. And like one of the waitresses, who was probably 14 or 15, but looks like an adult to me. I'm so freaking young. She's like, "How's your burger?" I remember my cousin was like, "It stinks." It's like, so bad. She's like, kind of dry. Great.
I like telling, you know, when they're like, someone walks over to the table and like, "How is everything?" Like, everything was great except the food and the service.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just to give them a chuckle. So when I went to college up in Albany, there was a place called Mild Wally's. Uh-huh. Any Albany people in the house? Mild Wally. Best sub I've ever had in my life. Really? And I had a lot of them. Mild Wally's. I think they're still there. But
we had a restaurant around here that was so friggin' good, but they closed. They were teetering. They had a 10-year celebration where I think the deals were a little too good and people took advantage of them and it put them in trouble. And they tried to come out of it, but it was tricky, and then the pandemic was the end of it.
James Norton said it's in Albany. Yep, Mild Wally's was in Albany. That's right. I forget the street it was on. There was a whole bunch of stuff on that street. There was a pizzeria over there also that was really good. It was like the end of the night slice of pizza, you know, 2-inch thick crust type of thing.
Yeah.
Put you to bed quick. Alan's Guitar Channel. Oh, his brother went to SUNY.
Blown in the head.
Yeah. Yeah, I went to SUNY Albany. Where'd you go to college?
Me?
Yeah.
UMass Boston.
Okay. Jimmy John's. I don't know if I ever had Jimmy John's.
I don't think I have.
There was another Subway place called... there was another one when
You ever go to Whataburger? People talked it up, but
I never had a Whataburger.
Yeah, down in Texas when I went to the Dallas show, there was a Whataburger right there. It was meh. It was okay.
You know what is a good burger? It's not overrated. Shake Shack has a really good burger.
Yeah, the problem is you need a magnifying glass to find it on your plate. And I do not find that their burgers are particularly large. In fact, I find that they're a pretty small, it's like they're shaving like the last little bit that they can. It's like they're putting the micrometer on that bun. They're going, let's go 2 microns smaller. There we go.
I don't remember having, I haven't had one in a while, but I remember it not being so small. You know, I remember enjoying it. Unless something changed, I don't know.
Oh, but it's delicious. I just feel like you, when you get it and you look at it, you feel like they were handing out free samples. You're like, wow, this is really small.
Five Guys is good too. I love
amazing.
I love Five Guys burger.
I think they're one of the best. I agree. Quickly prepared, you know, and I guess it technically it is fast food, the best one out there.
You know what's interesting, though? They only cook their burgers well done, but they are juicy.
They are.
I cook a well-done burger, it's burnt. I don't get it.
You know, it's probably because they're cooking it on a griddle. Oh, there's no place for the fat to go.
Oh, so
right?
It's
they
all...
They don't cook it on, right? They cook it on a griddle. Right. It's on a flat surface. It's not on a grill.
So everything that should be falling out of it isn't.
It marinates in its own juices.
Yeah, Five Guys is and Al John also wrote what I think he said In-N-Out, right, Al John? I like In-N-Out.
Yeah, I like In-N-Out until someone spills an entire drink on you.
So,
then I'm out.
Do you want to tell the story?
Do you want to tell a story?
So, Steve from Boston and I were in an In-N-Out burger.
Minding our own business.
And what happened exactly?
I have no idea.
It was a young girl.
If it wasn't a young girl, I would have been far more interrogative.
Yeah, I think there was a girl who had like one of those big Cokes, and didn't she trip on you or something?
I don't know what happened. I just heard the sound of the ice hitting my seat, and it was right down my freaking back. I have no idea how it got from her hands to down my back and in my row. And she was like cleaning the ice up and she's all apologies. But I never really found out exactly how did we get here? Did you trip? Were you not looking? What happened? You know, I would have loved to have seen that. I imagine if we looked at the video and you saw her walk over and like do it on purpose.
And I remember getting into the car. You were, dude, your jeans were soaked.
My back was so soaked, I had to take my shirt off and turn it around so that the dry part on the front was now on the back. So that when I sat in your rental car, I didn't get the seat all soaked with Coke.
Right.
And then we get in the car and you're like, I'm hungry. You want to go over to Roscoe's and get a waffle for dessert? I'm like, are you fucking serious right now? Dude, are you joking? You're like, oh, right, the joke thing.
Oh, you can't make this stuff up.
Yeah, that was a memorable night.
And last thing on food before we wrap it up, Roscoe's. I love Roscoe's.
And we got to meet Roscoe, remember?
No. Refresh my memory.
The guy who came to the table to give us the receipt that we had to pay. Like this old dude, I go, that's Roscoe. And you're like, get out of here. I'm like, trust me, that's Roscoe. I had no idea who it was. I'm going, that's Roscoe. Then you ask the waitress, is that Roscoe? It's Roscoe. Dead. I'm like, oh, I almost had him. What's happening? Zed's too little respect to Roscoe.
Zed's dead.
Oh.
Oh, man. Yeah, well, Andrew Bonica was with us. Well, I don't know if we were there together.
Oh, my God, Andrew Bonica was with us.
He was there, right? Yeah. But who else was there? Was that when Ike was with us? Was that the same? I think it was me, you, Andrew, Ike, and someone else. There was definitely someone else there. Andrew, was Ike with us? Flipside Ike?
Was Ike with us?
I think he was.
Yeah.
Andrew will remember.
Yeah, Andrew would. We were drunk on waffles that night.
Oh, man. I love that. That, yep. That food is so good.
I got
good.
Pretty sure I got the half dark, half white.
That's right. The extra people.
You went all dark.
I did go all dark.
I remember your order.
There was a picture of it on my Instagram.
Yeah.
Wow. Took a picture of that.
I was like, look at you going all dark.
Those plates were huge. They were huge.
They were huge.
They were huge.
They were good. I'm like, how do you eat this?
Yeah. You know what?
You just wrap that chicken right over that waffle right over that chicken.
Andrew was one of the people with you, the guitar player gal. Jimenez, I think her name was. I think she was there, wasn't she? Man, this is like
this is two old guys trying to remember.
Trying to remember. Grandpa Joe says, before everyone checks, let's give the Tone King a thumbs up for making us look for an all-night dinner. You know, we're all gonna go upstairs and eat now. But you know what the secret to the Roscoe's waffles are? They put cinnamon in the batter.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's like cinnamon sugar in that batter.
Huh.
Yep. Anyway, my fellow rockers. Oh, Flipside was there too. That's what I thought. I remember that. Yep. But good times. All right, my fellow rockers, I want to thank you, as always, for being here tonight. Hopefully you got to enjoy the demo of the D'Angelico. All the links are in the description below. And Steve from Boston, thank you for joining, dude. I always enjoy the last-minute hangouts. So
yeah.
Good stuff. My fellow rockers, I'm going to leave you all off with one of those bad boys right there. Thank you, as always, for watching. And until next time, rock on. See you later.